Bible passage and take an event of the Bible passage and put it on the newscast, what would it be like? If we could take Moses in Israel trying to bail and get Israel out of Egypt, and we do a play-by-play, hourly newscast. Today Moses went down to the king Pharaoh and said, let my people go. But the king reportedly said that he wasn't going to do so. Hour later, breaking news, the frogs just came up. The next day, lice. And if you could take the events of that time and put it on the newscast, you would be amazed at how it would sound on the ABC News Tonight or Good Morning America. If you could take those events, the lice, the plagues, the frogs, the lights are out in Egypt, but there's light in Goshen. How can this be? We're going now to the reporter in Goshen. Tell us. We got light down here. What y'all got going on up there? You know, what I am saying is that that's all we're doing now. 200 years from now, when we look back on this day that we're going through, and history has been made, and it's now in the history books, who the president was, and what he did, who the cabinet was, and all the shifts that were going on. You see, it will be news to those 200 years from now, but we're living it now, and we don't recognize that something is going on now that God ordained. And while it's going on, we don't recognize as God because we get too upset about what it's going on. It's like Israel in their time being upset because they couldn't get out of Egypt. Later to find out, 500 years from the time they were getting upset, that God was all in it. That God was orchestrating it. All history is, and you don't realize that your Bible is nothing but a history book. It's about events that took place at a time. And those who were living those events did not see it in a spiritual vein. It was life to them. It was a part of what's going on. What's going on in our time? It's news. It's news. Isn't it a shame that we've got a president who fires people by tweet? Let me tell you something. Let me tell you something. What if I were to tell you that to attack Trump is the same as attacking God? What if I were to tell you your conversation against Trump is an insult to God? Because you are actually saying God didn't know what he was doing by allowing him to be put in office. I'm not going to tell you that. But what I'm trying to say is there are events today that are going on that 100 years from now they'll be called history. But 100 years from now, those people will be able to look and say, look what God did. It has been said that history can be said to be his his story. Now, linguistically, by language, there's nothing to substantiate that. There is no division of that language or that word that goes back into the original language that says it means his story. It does not mean that. It means to know is what the word history means. And it's a compilation of events that are equated as being stories. And therefore, it comes together as being history from the word historia, which means to know. Here are things that you should know that took place in the events. Everything that has come and has happened since the creation of man from Adam through the garden, through the history of the prophecies, the prophets, major, minor, everything that happened to Israel. We look back now, crossing of the Red Sea. At one time, that was an event. For us, it's a spiritual happening. We preach about it. What is going on today, there's not a whole lot of preaching on it because we don't know what's going on. We're confused. Our president confused us. One day he's Rocket Man, next day we're going to make peace. Which is it? Who knows? So we don't really know what's going on now. North Korean and South Korean leaders come together and they French kiss. We don't have a clue what's going on. Marvin Gaye was right. What's going on? Everything that has gone on in the Bible was history. It was an event that was taking place in that time, and we only understand it now because God raised up someone to write about it on a different level, on a spiritual level. For Egypt, for Israel coming out of Egypt, it was news. Israel came out of Egypt. Somehow they got across the Red Sea. How they did it, we'll never know. It was an act of God. No big deal. An event. Unusual event. But no major significance to it. But now it is. We're able to receive inspiration, comfort, courage. We're motivated. We're blessed by it. We shout by it. We run around the track by it. Because we see it as not just history. We see it as an intervention of God putting his hand there, that the heart of the king was turned. Pharaoh thought he was in control, but the heart of the king was turned by the hand of God. You see, things that overwhelm us affects our head. Things that overwhelm us affect our heads. And things that are too much for us. We say, oh, I can't take it anymore. I got a headache. I get a migraine from thinking about it. How many have been there, done that? God is never overwhelmed by which his head is impacted. Because as our verse says, the king's heart is in the hand of the Lord like channels of water, and he turns it wherever he wants. The part that God takes every issue with is not in the head, but in his hand. Nothing impacts God's head. Oh, that I'm overwhelmed. I'm overwhelmed by what Trump is doing. I'm overwhelmed by what Congress is doing. I'm overwhelmed. God is never overwhelmed because everything is in his hand. He controls everything that goes on. It's in his hand. Never in his head, always in his hand. The heart of the king, whatever the pleasure of the king is like channels of water to him. And he's able to take what gets away from most of us. He's able to get it and take a hold of it and turn it whatever way he wants to. God has always dealt with individuals, personalities, strong personalities, unusual personalities, who thought and felt that they had a grip on life beyond the time that they were even set to be in the earth. There are four major world powers as far as the scripture is concerned. Now, we ought to get a lesson from that, because the Bible recognizes four world powers. First being Babylon, that goes from Genesis all the way into Revelation. Babylon the Great has fallen. Babylon was the first great empire in the world as far as the Bible is concerned, that left an impact, Nimrod, whatnot, left an impact on the world. And the kings that were associated with Babylon, we know some of them, Nebuchadnezzar and Belshazzar. It was a world empire that the Bible recognizes. The second was that when the king of Babylon thought himself to be more than he was, and God had to humble him and let him know, I am the king and you're not. I pray that you won't live in a way that God has to remind you who you are and who you're not. Because when the Bible says, let us not think. You see the tendency in us, that we have a tendency to think more highly of ourselves. And there are things that happen to us in life that will cause us, if we're not careful, to think more highly of ourselves than we ought. Just the promotion on your job can make you feel, whoo, I got it going on. When you get a promotion and you're raised above your peers, just that little bit of raise can make you feel that I've got it going on and they're peons under me. Just a little bit. Just a new house can change people's attitude. Getting a new car. Child, that's a bad ride you got. Thank you. You see, it doesn't take much for us. And don't let us get $130 in our savings accounts. We'll give God $10 a day. I'll even give him 11. But I got it going on, child. See, it doesn't take much for us to be elevated in our own thinking. And don't work your way all the way up from the lowlands of life to the White House or to the palace or to Congress and become in the realm of a king where you think that you are it. And we don't realize it today that what we're dealing with in Washington are egomaniacs, men who think they are in control. A Bannon who thought he was in control, and 24 hours you're out. A Manafort, a Tillerson, and God says, I raise up one, and I set him down. We think it's the instability of a man bringing people in and out. Y'all not listening to me. Y'all sing your song, but you don't put it together in life. Men do not set up one and take down another. God says, I do that. How does God set up one and take down another? He does it by controlling the king and turning him any way he wants to. Elder Rich is here today. He's known for puppets. He's a master at making it appear that the dummy is talking. Some of you are looking at the dummy talking and get upset because the dummy is talking. And everything that the dummy is saying is being manipulated. Every king in high places is nothing but a puppet on the stage of time. And God is manipulating Putin, Trump. Trump. Kiss Putin. We're watching a play. We don't even realize that we're watching God's theater as he manipulates kings from all over the world, speaking all kind of languages. But none of them are speaking on their own. They don't nod until God. They don't open their mouth until God. You've got to realize that the strings are being pulled by a holy God who sets up one, takes down another. Moses, go to Pharaoh. Tell Pharaoh that I said, let my people go. Pharaoh, no, I'm not going to let them go. Moses, be still. You don't need to be upset because Pharaoh won't let him go. I got some stuff I'm going to throw in the game. See, we get upset and we get all worked up over God's play. If we can go to Black Panther and see the awesomeness of what we think is happening all over the world, and it's just in the studio. Oh, my God. We thought we were seeing a view of the world. It's in Marvel Studio. That Marvel has put all of these things together, and we are deceived by thinking it's greater than it is. We look at men and we think there's more to them than really is. And God's just got them in his studio. We sang about it when we were children, but we didn't believe it. But we sang it anyhow. He's got the whole world in his hand. He got the whole wide world. In his hand, he's got the whole world. In his hand, he got the whole world in his hand. So we move from Babylon, who thought they were all that, and I'm coming back to Babylon, and we move on from Babylon, the kings of Babylon, Shazars, to Media, and Persia, that eventually came under the headship of Cyrus. Put a pin in it. Say my subject with me. Sean Shaw. Coming back there. Because something happened under the mindset of Cyrus. Let me move. I'll be back. And then we go to one who, after Cyrus thought that he was all of what he was not, come on, say Shansha, that there was a young man whose name was Alexander. And he, with tremendous military genius, moved and conquered Medo-Persia and set up the Greco Empire, Alexander the Great, whereby Greece became the power that be, the language Greek became the power. Not realizing that all of this was being orchestrated by God. That when, let me leave that alone. I'll come back. And then we move from Alexander the Great, who covered the world, to the Caesars and the Roman Empire. We don't understand that what God was doing was that the Greek would become the language that the gospel would be written in, and Rome would become the technicians that would get the gospel out through their roads, through their construction, through their building. That God had each empire play a part in what he was doing to pave the way for Jesus Christ to come. Because history really is, whether it's validated or not, it really is his story, because everything that God did before Calvary pointed to Calvary, and everything that was done after Calvary pointed back to Calvary. That Calvary really is the central figure and central point in which God is aiming. Everything has an end goal. Everything, there's an end game to it. 1 Corinthians 15:24, where God says, then the end will come. Everything is not just going to go on and 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 on. The whole point is that everything is going toward an end. As much as we like to think we're going to be around, there's going to be an end. You may hit the lottery today, but there's an end to it. Everything has an end. What is God's end game? God is taking all of history from Adam to now to work in his plan toward the end. Then the end will come. Now look at this. That when after he has done away with every ruler, every king, every president, ought to read this passage, that verse right there. You don't need to read anymore. That after he has done away with every, with no exception, ruler and every authority and every power, after every ruler surrenders and say, I give. Whether they give up to illness, to assassination, to death, every ruler has an end. And the thing that I marvel about, that if God only considers four world empires, if you will take note, God did not name the United States as one of them. So what we call greatness, God doesn't even talk about. Are you hearing what I'm saying? We live in the greatest nation under the earth, and yet God says you do? Who are you? God says, I've had greater presidents. I've had greater men in power. Smarter. More intelligent. With more ability. With more keenness. With more insight than you know anything about. You're not even one of the powers that I talk about. However, because you call yourself a ruler and authority, I'm going to get rid of you too. I'm going to close with point number two. I've got 12 points. The interesting thing about this passage in Proverbs, that the king's heart is in the hand of the Lord, like channels of water. And he turns it wherever he wants. Solomon, in writing Proverbs, or those who contributed to Proverbs, not necessarily Solomon only, but Solomon primarily, he writes in such a way until he writes what he's thinking at the moment. You can't read Proverbs as a story. It's just thoughts of wise thoughts thrown in here and there. Pithy, it's called pithy, P-I-T-H-Y, pithy sayings, wise sayings. And they're just strewn about whenever he thinks about it. Like I'm thinking now, pray for Terrence. He lost his father-in-law yesterday, and Roberto lost his cousin this week. Be in prayer for these individuals who are grieving. And so Solomon just writes what he's thinking. He writes this. The king's heart is in the hand of the Lord like channels of water. He turns it wherever he wants. I'm sure that was applicable to him because he was a king. In his experience, he found that God did this to him, that he found out he wasn't all that. However, I was curious about the context of this, the history of this history. Was there an event that took place in time that was an event, but it caused Solomon to think, wow, that really happened. So let me write it down. The king's heart is in the hand of the Lord, like channels of water. What took place in history that caused this to be written? I need my arm. Thank you. That caused this to be written. In the Persian government, in the Persian Empire, that would be world power number two, Babylon, and then Medo-Persia. At the end of Babylon, at the beginning of Medo-Persia, King Belshazzar, or Shazar, was in power. And for some reason, he decided to bring all of his staff, let me call it, leaders, men in government, into a place to celebrate. To celebrate, period. Have you ever thought, get me the Jeremiah scripture, have you ever thought that what you're doing, God has already said you're going to do it before you did it? The good things you do, the bad things you do, do you realize that maybe what you're doing, all you're doing is fulfilling prophecy? Do you realize that the attitude you have about some things, all you're doing is fulfilling what God said you would fulfill? Oh my brain is going 1,000 miles a minute. I'm trying to organize it, but I don't know what I'm talking about. So just let me talk. You're listening to a crazy man. Have you ever wondered if God is in control? Why does he let certain things happen if he's in control and he doesn't want the credit for it? How? Keep it up there so I won't forget it. How could a righteous God send a wicked Pharaoh to hell if God made Pharaoh for that purpose? How can he judge Pharaoh if he created Pharaoh knowing what he would do? So why am I going to hell? I'm going to answer somebody. Why am I going to hell if God made me this way? Knowing that if you push a certain button, I would curse you out. And if I do, then he's going to send me to hell after he made me this way. This is just the way I am. How can God send Moses to Pharaoh and tell Pharaoh to let my people go, knowing that Pharaoh is not going to let God's people go because Pharaoh, his heart was hardened by God? Y'all don't hear me today. And every one of us sometimes become confused by God because it sounds contradictory. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. I got a chapter and a verse, but I don't know where the book is. It says 9:14-18. I think it's Romans. Romans 9:14-18. Are we saying then that God was unfair? Find that. I'll come back to Jeremiah. Are we saying then that God was unfair? Of course not. For God said to Moses, I will show mercy to anyone I choose. I will show compassion to anyone I choose. Thank you. It is wrong. So it is who God who decides to show mercy. Are you paying attention? All right. For the scripture says that God told Pharaoh. Understand. That God created Pharaoh. Who created Pharaoh? God created Pharaoh. And yet, God is sending Pharaoh to hell for the way he created him. Okay, let's go on. I have appointed you for the very purpose. What I'm saying to you, folk who sin, folk who disobey, folk who are negative, folk who are evil, folk who are mental. Don't look around. They're that way because God made them that way. I have appointed you for the very purpose of displaying my power. Whoa! Whoa! Look at that. That God has to have a Pharaoh type to display his power. Because if he had one who was sweet and nice and kind and would do everything that everybody wanted him to do, he couldn't display his power. He needs somebody nasty. He needs somebody who will cuss you out. See, people don't know your good qualities until you get those good qualities tested. And when something happened to you, it's not as good as you thought it was. You see, you don't know I'm mean until you bother me. As long as you leave me alone, all you see is Bishop. He's so kind. He's so loving. I never see anything. He's the same all the time. You know why? Because you haven't bothered me. God creates individuals to bother you so he can display his power one way or the other through you. It had to be a Roman soldier. Not a disciple, but a Roman soldier. To put him on the cross, because his friends never would put him on the cross. Not like that. They might talk about him a little bit like Peter did. And Jesus had to turn around and say, "Get behind me, Satan." That's the worst that would happen out of his disciples. But God needed someone to hate Jesus enough to drive some nails through his hands. Because if he couldn't find somebody who was mean enough and nasty enough and hated Jesus enough to put him to death, there could never be a proof of resurrection. So, God put Jesus on the cross. How did he put him on the cross? He used men who hated him. And God could not wait until hatred bloomed to its fullness. He needed hatred to bloom to its fullness so that they would kill him. The enemies killed him. You need the enemy to do it, because they are not going to fix the story up. And so you need the enemies to do a number. Put the spikes in his hand, the crown on his head. Let him bleed all over the place. The spike, pierce him in the side. Put his feet on the cross. Drive him. Give it your best shot. God says, I need folk like that in your life. Y'all not hearing me. You think I'm talking about Jesus, and I'm talking about you. You need folk in your life. I'll save you walking. You need folk in your life. You need folk in your life who are antagonistic to you, who can't stand you with that short bob white hair, whatever that is. You think you're cute, don't you? If you need to take a good look in the mirror, because that ain't Jack. You don't look like nothing. If I were you, I'd... See, she needs somebody to tell her that, so that what's truly in her can come out. And let me tell you, in those times, if your testimony is not in you, your testimony ain't coming out of you. God says, in order to display my power, I need to create a Pharaoh. A Pharaoh I know is never going to get saved. Y'all not hearing me? Follow along. Most of you don't witness anyhow, but let me say this to those who might. There are some folk you're praying for who never will get saved. They're not designed to be saved. It doesn't matter how much you pray for them, they won't be saved. You don't know who they are. You won't know who they are because you don't know God's purpose in creating them. But God knows that there are people in your house who you may sleep with, who you may have birthed into the world. Do you not understand that some mother birthed Pharaoh? Y'all not hearing me today. Some mother birthed a Roman soldier that would have nerve enough to take a spear and pierce the heart of Jesus. But God needed that so that he could display his power. Lord, have mercy. Now let me try. I don't know what I'm talking about, but let me try. How is it possible that God that God can create a purpose, create a person to sin, and yet keep his hands clean? Next time I come, I'll preach a little skip to the lube message, but right now trying to give you something to chew on. How can God create one for evil without being evil? And how can I use you to do evil and then turn around and send you to hell? After using you, I send you to hell because of what you did. God is that kind of God that he doesn't make you do anything. But because he knows what's in you and because he knows you are unyielding and you won't submit no matter how much you hear the gospel, he comes up with a plan to use you and your stubbornness and your disobedience for his purpose. He doesn't make you do it, but he knows what you're going to do. And he said, okay, since you're going to do that, I can use you. I'm going to let you work out the fullness of what's in your heart on my people so I can be glorified. Because when you give it your best shot, when you put him in the grave, I'm going to raise him up. And I'm going to condemn you to hell because you heard the gospel too. But you in your obstinance decided you didn't want any parts of it. And so I'm not responsible for what you made up your mind to do. But because you made up your mind to do it, I'm going to use you. Am I making sense to anybody? I'm glad you understand it because I don't. Come on. I have appointed you. God says, nobody did this but me. I have appointed you for the very purpose. Would you tell somebody next to you, you have a very purpose? And you know what? You're going to fulfill that very purpose. Child, she ain't about nothing. Well, if that's what she is, she's fulfilling a purpose. God wants to show folk how it looks for people who ain't about nothing. And he's got some ain't about nothing people to motivate those who want to be something. God's going to use everything and everybody that he created for a purpose. Come on, tell somebody, I was created for a purpose. Y'all got me on my track. Let's see. I'm trying. So I can display my power in you and to spread my fame. God says, I'm going to use your stupidity to make myself more famous. God says, I need somebody who's stupid enough to be used by the devil so I can be more famous. Lord, have mercy. Y'all not hearing me today. Ask somebody, is God using you to be more famous? Why are hypocrites in the church? Because God needs them. Since you're going to be a hypocrite, he will show you what happens when you're a hypocrite so that others might learn a lesson. God never removes his hand from anything. He's always using it for his glory. I want my fame to be out through the earth, throughout the earth. He doesn't use a preacher. He doesn't use an evangelist. He uses a hard-hearted man who is a king called Pharaoh so that his fame can go throughout the earth. See, some of you are not advertising him. So he's got to use somebody who's against him to advertise. Oh, so you see, God chooses to show mercy to some. If you're saved today, that's your line. That he chose to show mercy to you. And you ought to be thanking him right now. You are the sum that God chose for mercy. You should have taken a board out your pew right there. That you are the sum that God chose for mercy because he could have put you in the other sum. That he chose to show mercy to some and he chooses to harden the hearts of others so they refuse. He didn't refuse. Who refused? They. And when you keep refusing, what happens to your heart? Hardened. And God needs some hardened hearts to use for his glory. And he does all that and stays God. I remember the day he never would have done that. But God takes you through stuff. And when he takes you through stuff, when you come back to his purpose, see, you can go for bad if you want to. But God will let you know I invented bad. I invented bad. Let me close. Let me try to make the text sense. Give me Jeremiah again. Now, Jeremiah prophesied a prophecy. It's longer than the two lines. It's 53 something. He prophesied. Thank you. He prophesied something, Jeremiah 51, 63, that says, and as soon, yes, as you finish reading this scroll, you will tie a stone to it. Tie a stone to the scroll. tie a stone to the scroll. Tie a stone to the word. There's a rock tied to to the scroll. I just preached and y'all missed it. I said there is a stone tied to the scroll. The scroll is the word, and the stone is and when you tie the stone to it, throw it into the middle. Because Jesus doesn't fit anywhere but in the middle. Where two or three are gathered in my name, there I am where? In. He's not going to take a back seat. He's not going to be out of the picture. Wherever he comes, he's coming right in the middle. Tie a stone or tie a stone around the scroll and throw it into the Euphrates. Now, the Euphrates is that river that ran through Babylon. It was the main river. And the only way that you could get into the city, there was a gate on one side, gates on the other, and then the river. It was the river that was the protection for the city. It was their main course for their economy. It was the river Euphrates. God said to Jeremiah, throw a stone with the scroll in the middle and say, just so shall Babylon sink down. It's going to sink. Wherever the word is thrown with Jesus on it, two things will happen. You will either rise or you will sink. You okay? Tell Babylon it's going to sink down and not rise again. You see, we look at things happening. We see them falling. We see them crumbling. And we see some things falling apart, and we try our best to save it. But some things you can't save because God put a word on it. There's some people you can't save because they got a word on them. There are some people who went one time too many and refusing to come to the altar. And God said, the city of Babylon, it's over for you. Now, how God destroys things, he doesn't need to make a great big display. Lightning, thundering, angels coming by and flinging all kind of sci-fi animals at you. He doesn't need to do that. God can destroy you in the most diplomatic way. He says, Jeremiah, Babylon is going to sink and not rise. Why? Because of the calamity that I'm going to bring upon her. Men, you ought to rejoice because Babylon's a woman. And they will become exhausted thus far. Are the words of Jeremiah. I close. Tony, take this away so I don't see nothing else. Cyrus! Who was the emperor of Persia. Who was the one to conquer. King Belshazzar. King Belshazzar is the one who's throwing a party in Daniel. Jeremiah has prophesied about Babylon. King Belshazzar is throwing a party for all of his elites. Get me Daniel 5:31 ready. And while Babylon is partying, God's word is working. See, why are you having the time of your life? God's at work fulfilling his word. And sometimes you think the party is overriding what God has said. And all your partying is doing is playing into the hands of God. Because the party was a distraction. Doesn't take much for God to work. While Belshazzar was partying, Cyrus, the Persian king, was planning the downfall of Babylon. While they were partying, Cyrus and his troops were digging trenches, channels, ditches around the Euphrates. And while they were digging trenches, channels around the Euphrates, they were partying, and the very empire palace that they were partying with the river around, the palace was there. But nobody noticed that the river was subsiding. They never stopped to see that their river, Euphrates, was sinking at an all-time high. And when Cyrus had sufficiently drained the swamp, they did not need to go into the gates. They didn't need to go through the gates to capture the city. They now had the means to go under the gates and rise up in the city and destroy Belshazzar and the city. So Cyrus took the city by changing the course of the river. What he actually did was turn the waters. Y'all not hearing me? You're not hearing me. Daniel says that very night, we get ourselves all in a dither because things haven't happened in our time. But God has a very night in your life. That very night, Belshazzar, king of the Babylonians, was slain. Give me 5 minutes, because in our times of victory, this is Cyrus who has brought about the victory over Babylon. Persia became the greatest empire the world has ever known. And during Cyrus's time of ruling, he became so lifted up until he called himself Shansha. Come on, say it with me. Shansha. Put that word up there. The man had nerve. Just because you won a few battles, because you've gotten a few victories in your life, don't think more highly of yourself than you ought to think. Because he titled himself, that is still a title in Persia, in Iraq, Iran, still use the title. Shahanshah. Do you not know what this means? Shah means king. On of Shah, kings. He called himself, I am the king of kings. But then God had to bring along an Alexander Great, and he had to bring along the Caesars, and lastly he had to bring along Jesus. Woo! And Jesus, oh Lord, coming down through 42 generations. Daniel said he was a rock hewn out the mountain, rolling down through every empire. And Jesus came down to 42 generations. And the Bible said that when he did it, he came down through Babylon first. The angel hollered out in Revelation, Babylon, the great, is fallen. Jesus removed the crown from the empire of Babylon. Belshazzar, Nebuchadnezzar, took their crowns, put it on his head, kept on rolling, rolled down through Medo-Persia, went and got the crown of Cyrus, put it on his head. Now he's got Belshazzar's crown. He's got Nebuchadnezzar's crown. He's got Artaxerxes' crown. He's got Cyrus's crown. He's got crowns all over his head. Then he's got Alexander the Great. He rolls down through Greece, removes the crown from Alexander, rolls through Rome, and gets Julius Caesar, Augustus Caesar. And when we get the revelation, John says, oh my God, he's got many crowns. Where did he get many crowns from? From all the kings, including Shansha. And when he took Shansha's crown, put it on his own head, it was a transference of power that he thought he had, but who actually belonged to Jesus Christ. Put those two last scriptures up in Revelation, and I'm done at the very end. What I am trying to say to you, and there were great voices in heaven. Whoa! There were great voices in heaven. Now you and I, where are we? Where? We're on earth. Oh, okay. Well, Paul didn't know that, because he said, Ephesians, that we are seated in heavenly places in Christ. Come on, ask somebody, where are you sitting? See, you can't be a voice in heaven if you're going to be on earth. You're on earth, but you're clamoring what's in heaven. You're a voice who's proclaiming what's in heaven. That's why we don't gain victory in our lives, because we're proclaiming the situation rather than proclaiming what's in heaven. In heaven, they are proclaiming the kingdoms of this world are become the kingdoms of our Lord and of his Christ. There's not going to be any more change of power. No more elections. For he shall reign forever and ever. Why? Because he's Shansha. Give me one more. You got one more there? Do the one before that. At the right time. At the right time, God will make known. He will make this known. What's he going to make known? That God is the blessed. And what? Lord have mercy. Yeah. He is the only ruler. He's Shansha. Tell somebody next to you, he's Shansha. Now you got phones. I know you got them. I know you're texting. I know you got them in there. You're reading texts next to your Bible. But I give you permission right now to type in Shansha. See what you find. That he is the King of Kings. He is the Lord of Lords. That Jesus Christ is more than man could ever be. No matter who he is, no matter what king he is, no matter what president he is, your president of the United States will never be Shansha. He's trying very hard. But every knee is going to bow. Every tongue is going to confess that Jesus Christ is Shansha.